pleasure, Mary, of course, to be here to further commemorate, as we are doing at Amherst College as well, Henry Steele Commager, who was obviously a giant of his time, of scholarship, an inspiration for us all to live up to that ideal, and someone who left an indelible mark upon the institution where I usually spend my time these days. So I should tell you that I'm here under slightly false pretenses. In fact, much of my life is false pretenses since I'm a college president. But the I'll speak for myself there. When Bob called and asked whether I would come and speak, I think ushering an invitation from the committee, the hope was that I would speak on a subject I did know something about, which was the subject of my scholarship, South Africa and issues around that. And I confess that while I think I did once know something on the subject, the benefits of being a college administrator means I simply would feel somewhat fraudulent and certainly out of date if I pretended to be a current expert on that. And so I thought, let me try to speak to something that I am working on and think a fair amount about. Though it does connect to the South Africa part of my life. So if you'll just forgive a sentence or two of autobiography, as a young man, 24 years old, I went to South Africa in the 1980s at a time when the country was on the verge of exploding and lived through the states of emergency and effectively civil war in that country. I had the privilege of working for an education group there. And it was probably the most important experience of my life. And I took at least two lessons from that. This was an education group where people were putting their lives on the line, literally, in the apartheid state, and sometimes losing their lives as a result, to further the basic sense of education as a crucial and arguably the crucial vehicle for social change and progress. That was an inspiration to me, obviously. I worked with that organization in setting up a college that took students from apartheid education and prepared them in a model very similar to the community college model in the United States that we were learning from at the time, to prepare them for the great universities, the research universities in South Africa that were claiming at the time that they would like to diversify. But of course, they couldn't find black students for that purpose because apartheid education had done such an efficient job of ensuring exactly that result. And it was also a powerful lesson to me to see over the years, thanks to the good work of my colleagues and not of me, I confess, about 1,000 students take that opportunity with 1 year, or sometimes two, of additional intense quality education and find that they could then compete at the finest universities in the land. There is a powerful lesson there, as I believe we talked about that night in Washington as well, of that even purposeful educational inequality and damage can be undone. It says something very powerful about the possibilities of human beings to overcome those odds in South Africa, and I dare say not just in South Africa. What is the purpose of higher education? Well, I could give you the lofty rhetoric, and I do actually believe in much of that lofty rhetoric about the seed corn of society and of civilization. But I'll be a little bit more pragmatic in answering that today. One is, higher education is a part of a system of finding and raising talent. It is a crucial element of the American sense and ideal of mobility based on talent. access through the higher into and through the higher education system is a fundamental funnel, a filter for that access in society. When it works, society benefits, and when it doesn't, society loses significantly. We are also engaged not only, obviously, in finding that talent, but in molding it through our teaching. And that should be aimed at both skills in the broadest sense and at thinking in the broadest sense. The education that we provide in higher education is indeed a foundation to the economy through the skills that we help to provide, to democracy in terms of an informed citizenship, and to civil society in the sense of people of varied backgrounds learning to be together, to learn together, and to work together. When it works, higher education is intended to and does inspire engagement and integrity. It is a sector of the society self-consciously directed at shaping the values of society. Those are high ideals. That's why many of us are in this business. Today, I suggest in the United States, those ideals are under fairly serious threat. Put simply, following the same three notions, access based on talent, mobility based on talent, is faltering in the United States. And I'll even go so far as to suggest there are elements of the American educational system that begin to look like an economic form of apartheid, which are strong words indeed. Of course, apartheid itself institutionalized racism. It was evident to all, and it was purposeful as such, self-consciously so. Economic or class apartheid in the United States takes a much subtler form. We pretend that that's not what's happening. Certainly, we don't fully believe it's what's purposefully happening. But the results suggest otherwise. Think about our K-12 system. Not only is it insufficiently funded, not only is it in so many ways not up to the task we need it to be up to at this point, it is by design an unequal system. The policy that drives the funding of K-12 education in America is based on property tax, by definition different. In fact, different by as much as a factor of 7 to 1 in this country in terms of per student expenditure. Now, I know from James Coleman and others that money isn't everything, but it sure helps. Access in terms of opportunities in higher education are faltering. State funding throughout the country for K-12, but also for the public universities, including the community colleges, is increasingly in peril. Public policy decisions being made that are tragically short-sighted. I'm pleased to see that here, there's evidence of some significant investment that I just walked through. I wish I could say the same for the system that the country has as a whole. In fact, our K-12 system, our system of the public universities, the community colleges, the private colleges and universities are not linked in any fundamental way. In fact, have somehow drifted apart, even competing with each other in odd ways, that also denies the possibility of access because it doesn't build clear roots from one sector of the educational system to the next. In terms of teaching skills and thinking, we face a moment, even in higher education, where the temptations of something like rote learning grow. And perhaps more powerfully or insidiously, the attractions of a narrow form of learning grow. As the disciplines have become more mature, the walls between them have grown, and the expertise specialty that we do rely on has become increasingly self-referential. Within that learning, the separation of cohorts based on differences of access, economic cohorts, racial cohorts, ethnic cohorts, you name it, also grows. I can only, I think, fairly speak for private higher education. I can't really speak for that. I can speak for one college, and I'm not always sure I'm allowed to speak for that. But I do see a trend of institutions of higher education, including the great colleges and universities of this land, increasingly acting as self-serving agents, even self-aggrandizing agents, competing with each other too often on brand name recognition, as if we were in a consumption model. And in doing so, we perhaps do even more damage than the faltering access or the mistakes in learning attempts impose. Because when the leading institutions act in self-aggrandizing ways, in self-serving ways, then the most fundamental lesson we're teaching our students is to be that. That is a very scary prospect to me in the 21st century. There is another possibility. I will try to picture it with you. One is a new form of partnership between higher education and the K-12 system. The community colleges are, in fact, a key link in that, because you can teach us on both sides how to make this cooperation work better. Private colleges like Amherst have their role to play. We've just launched a Center for Community Engagement that we hope will encourage most of our students to engage in public school service activities locally and to engage in issues of public education during their time at Amherst. And we will be shaping a curriculum accordingly. We need to partner with the community colleges, and as President Pura referred to, our partnership through the Cook Foundation grant and those scholars is one that we prize but is all too precious, too few. Obviously, the spaces at a place like Amherst are too few, but certainly the opportunities for that kind of mobility are not what they should be. Clearly, cooperation between the public universities and the private colleges and universities also essential. In fact, thinking of that just this morning, meeting with the acting chancellor at UMass, continuing a conversation about how we can share in meeting the curricular interests of our students, since no one institution can do everything. If we do not cooperate effectively, including on curriculum, we limit the possibilities of the reach of our students. In my view, cooperation is key to turning the bleaker picture of America's higher education system, perhaps the exaggeration, but still scary picture of the worrisome trends in our system. Cooperation is key. I'll come back to that. In terms of learning, one can imagine a higher education system that is global in its reach. that makes sure that every student has some basic background in the science and maths that they are going to need in the 21st century, in the arts to shape an aesthetic and a sense of values, and at least by my money, fundamentally in terms of writing skills, which are so crucially connected to the skill of thinking. The cooperation also goes to the issue of the example that we set. When we compete in ways that drive so many public and private universities to use merit-based aid packages that direct scarce financial aid resources to students who need it less in order to boost our own standing, and I should say Amherst does not do this, then not only are we modeling that kind of behavior, but we're also leaving less resources for precisely the access that we say we're after. When private universities indulge in admissions competition, like the increasing percentage drawn through early decision, not, in my view, because of the real interests of the students, but again, because of the self-interest of the institution. When we let rankings move our policy decisions and our investments in order to strategize that game, and it is a game, then we are modeling the wrong behavior. If we can cooperate, it should be possible for us to ensure as a system access that uses funds most efficiently so that our competition by what one institution can do doesn't drive other institutions into misbehavior. We can limit admissions policies so that they serve the public good. We can distance ourselves from the rankings and judge ourselves in more substantive ways. So there is a brighter picture of possibility in higher education. I suppose it is an interesting question whether we will find our way to that brighter picture. One of the questions, I suppose, is how far down the road toward the darker picture are we? Since you have to remember, we're not just talking about the sort of direction of a sector like manufacturing or something else. We're talking about the directions of a sector of our society that actually shape the values that then assess the directions of the society. That's good news if you believe in education. It's also scary news if you believe that the sector is driving those values in a way that will be hard to reverse at some point. Leadership is crucial. You know that from having it here. Each institution will have to do what it can do, and there will be differences there. Let me confess some realities about the institution that that I preside over, or at least ostensibly. No, I'm going to be positive because I'm a college president, Mary. An institution like Amherst, I believe all institutions, though we will differ, needs to take a stand, needs to assert the values, in our case, of our founding, and the values that we aspire to live up to. Now, I'm aware that Amherst is a distinctive institution. It is today both the most selective liberal arts college in America. It is also today the most diverse liberal arts college in America. That combination, we believe, is powerfully Amherst and powerfully American. It puts to the lie the assumption that diversity cuts against, is a trade-off from intellectual standards and rigor and selectivity. And it is, in effect, the college taking a stand on these issues by saying, we will put our money where our mouth is, literally. We have worked fairly vigorously at making sure that students from the bottom end of the economy, who are great students, and again, that is a condition for Amherst, are thinking about Amherst as a possibility, to get that word out, to use our own students to help get that word out, our alumni, to use the media to the degree that we can manage it, to get that word out. This summer, the college said, we are not a one-note Charlie on access. We're also deeply concerned about middle-class students. And the college announced, because it has the resources to announce, or the access to resources to make possible, that we would no longer ask our students to take any loans at all to come to Amherst College. And that policy, let me confess, is directed square on to the middle class squeeze, because kids from the bottom end of the economy already weren't getting grants, getting loans expected from Amherst College. But the middle class were feeling squeezed, especially even with fairly serious incomes, having several kids in a private university or college, for instance. You can do the math as well as I can. So we said, let's be dramatic there, and let's hope that other institutions will follow. I'm pleased to report that my distinguished colleagues in Williams announced a week ago that they would no longer be expecting loans of their students. Other institutions have done so in less complete form because they may not have the resources that we do to do this dramatically, but clearly, competition, in some ways, driving us positively may not be the perfect substitute for cooperation, but when it works, I'll take it. Again, agreements, taking a stand on the rankings, saying this summer with 20 of our fellow presidents, and that was an interesting political science exercise, if ever there was one, agreeing that we would no longer cite our rankings publicly, that we would distance ourselves from the rankings. We wouldn't provide the information directly. We put it out publicly so that everyone could assess it and use it in various ways, and that we'd work with other agencies on alternative rankings and try to convince the ranking magazines to rank us in ways that push us in progressive directions, that say, okay, how is your economic diversity or your racial diversity, or how can we assess the quality of the education you're providing, rather than how much money can you spend, which is what the rankings currently are basically a measure of. Now, let me close with an obvious confession. We know that what Amherst can do in this front is not what other institutions can do. We are very mindful, I am very mindful, of the sort of privileged position based on a couple hundred years of alumni generosity and the amazing powers of cumulative interest, if I got that right, that we can do things that not everyone else can do. And that makes the test for us even harder, and I'd love your thoughts on how to sort of think our way through this, because I worry about this. I know it's a nice problem to worry about. I worry about other things as well, but there may be things in terms of leadership positions that Amherst College can do and arguably should do that are good things to do for Amherst College and for those who benefit from Amherst College. And I confess I have an institutional responsibility to take those seriously, obviously. But I actually think that places like Amherst have a responsibility beyond that to say what we do shouldn't just be in our self-interest, but we have to think about what the ripple effects will be for the system as a whole. And you could sort of think through the possibilities there. It is imaginable that a few institutions could use their resources to further throw resources at the financial aid system. At the extreme, you could even imagine a moment where half a dozen institutions in America, Harvard an obvious example, Princeton and Harvard an obvious example, declare that they will no longer charge tuition whatsoever. And I assure you, this is a debate that's happening in the boards of all those institutions. I will confess to you, Amherst is not in a position to do that. If any of you have an extra $1 billion, I would certainly be happy to consider it. But the point of my remarks, I do that too, right? the point of that comment is, even if we had the resources, we have to test that, even as a heuristic device, as a sort of thought experiment, against what would happen when everybody else could not possibly follow. Would we create an effect in which other institutions scrambling to compete with us without the resources would do things that would be counterproductive to the larger aims that we were after? So, for instance, a massive arms race in merit aid, because you can't afford it for every student, so you target the students you want and you buy them, which is what merit aid is, in effect. And then there's less resources in the system outside of half a dozen institutions going to those who most need it. That would be a classic example of how well-intentioned sort of leadership from elite institutions could go seriously wrong in terms of the system-wide effects. If we're going to get to a better higher education system, we're going to have to think through all those problems, just as I suggest there are issues and challenges for us to think through, for all of us to think through. Let me stop there and open it up. I'd love to hear questions, comments, discussion. It's a subject you all know as much about as I do. Yes?
In terms of access, I have a friend who is at Yale, and they're working on a program to put Yale courses online for free. And I wonder if you've given any thought about it at Amherst, or where?
We've been working hard to get to the end of the 20th century in information technology. We're almost there. As we move towards that, we talk about additional uses of it. We're certainly mindful of, I'm sure Yale's considering it, MIT has already done it. The MIT experiment, from what I hear, though I will confess I'm not yet an expert on this because the issue hasn't bubbled up sufficiently, is that it's not getting, that all courses at MIT, many of the courses are available online, but they're not getting the hits that they expected. They're not getting the reaction that they expected. And it may be that simply putting things online is insufficient, and that there's a reason why we do what we do in the classroom, for instance. I guess I do believe that in the end, and we do talk about this, we will put increasing amounts of, say, our syllabi, our readings, you know, some lectures online as a public service, and I think we should do that. I think there will be some price to that for us in terms of, you know, somebody will say, I can't believe you're teaching it this way, or that you left that out, or you put this in. Or, you know, reaching out to the faculty and saying, can I talk to you for half an hour, when the faculty member already has, you know, students lined up outside the door. I think those are prices we will have to pay and should pay, especially if we can afford to. That said, I will perhaps surprise you with my old-fashionedness. Amherst College stands for, basically a 19th century model of education. We have an 8-to-1 faculty ratio, 10 kids in a room with a faculty member, and office hours conversations going on aplenty. It is not only, it's fair to say, not only is it inefficient, it's meant to be inefficient. It's proudly inefficient. And we actually happen to believe it's still the best model of education, though we understand that it by definition, can't be available to everyone in the same way. It costs us $80,000 a year to educate a student at Amherst. So even those who are paying full ride are being subsidized almost equal amount by the endowment of the college at this point. I know that's not going to happen as a sort of everyone experience. I do still believe, though, in that old-fashioned model as well, but I think we can have both. At least I hope we can. Please.
It's wonderful to hear the president of Amherst College have such a public purpose or public agenda in his thinking about higher education. Let me just say outright that I have rarely heard that. And it's so important to all of us to hear that. I really do appreciate it. My suggestion or thought would be that maybe it's time in this area to open up the idea of Five Colleges, Inc. be a bit more inclusive of institutions. Five Colleges, Inc. is not provided. I read Five Colleges, Inc. and what it's right. done for all of its members. And so I'm not trying to say that we take that organization officially and change it.
Right, right.
But I do think that the interchange of ideas and skills and attitudes and resources and things that could happen if we brought not only the four privates plus UMass together with the community colleges and the state's colleges in a region that includes Springfield right. and Holyoke would be a very interesting, and we might actually model for the nation what can happen when publics and privates work together.
Right.
leader on these subjects, I would love to have you think about it.
Well, I will think about it. I am proud of the fact that we have increased in some informal ways and through the Cook Grant, for instance, in some formal ways, more of partnership already here, Holyoke, et cetera. But I do think that's an interesting model to think about. Let me just confess to you that what that's up against, right? Well, partly, I don't need to say what it's up against, but you can imagine it. But the reality is when we get together at the five colleges, we're spending an increasing amount of time trying to think about how to get more out of that five institution level of cooperation, how to make it go deeper, right? So that it isn't that each institution says, and this is a caricature of a sort of cultural phenomenon that I hope is no longer with us, but the sense of, well, you know, if it's not that important, we'll let the five colleges do it. If it's important, we need to do it for ourselves. Which is not a particularly helpful basis for cooperation. So we're committed to deepening that relationship. And I will tell you, that is already taking some effort and work. As you might imagine, there are differences of culture just of those five institutions. That may make it harder for us to expand the agenda fully at this point, given that's where we're focusing. But I do think it would be consistent. And I'll certainly be thinking of a way to pursue that with my colleagues. Yes, ma'am.
My question pertains to the community engagement initiative involving Amherst College and the public school system.
Right, right.
Are you simultaneously funding educational research, local educational research that will be used to inform local, state, and national policy around education?
Well, first, I should be clear. We are not an ed school, right? And so there will be a limit to what we will do in that. But that said, the Center for Community Engagement brings with it is funded by a very generous 7-year grant, which means, unlike most things that we do, it is not in perpetuity. We have to prove to ourselves, to our donors, that we're actually doing a good job. That means, unlike some other things we do, we're going to be very serious about assessment. That is a form of research of the effect of this effort on our students and on in the case of partnerships with the public schools, on the public school students. And we'll certainly be public about that. And you know, I think we may find a model of greater cooperation in terms of community engagement through that center that we will want to certainly spread the word on, including the word in assessment terms. Again, conscious of the fact that it's a model that is, you know, going to be hard to replicate everywhere given the costs involved. But I'll just give another example, sorry, slight segue. Amherst can raise funds to make it possible to give paid internships to our students. Not every institution can do that. It's something, again, it's a privilege for us. We need to be responsible about it, which is what we're trying to do now. And to connect it to the curriculum so it isn't just sort of hanging out there by itself. But one of the things I have come to learn is, and again, it gets me into no end of trouble, is a great, we have a great resource, which is our students eager to do this. Given the cost of higher education, more than half of our students are on work study at this point. I just use that as an example. And that's true nationally. And the work study program was intended, designed to pay students to do community engagement work, not to boost the budgets of our institutions through work on campus. Now, I know we've become reliant on that source of funding, and again, I'm conscious of the fact that it's easier for me to think of alternatives for that than at other institutions. But certainly, if the country wanted to be serious about getting students involved in the public school system as a most obvious partnership of community engagement for any university or college, the work-study funds are there to be directed. And it would be interesting to see if the feds wanted to engage in that in a serious way. So the segue there was to say, yes, we will be assessing, yes, we will be publicizing it. It may not be the full level of research that if we had an ed school we would be doing, though we have been talking to the university ed school about doing this with us, as well as other partners, other ed schools elsewhere. We're quite committed to that. But I also wanted to say, and we want, because we know we're assessing a model that is not by definition so easily replicable, we're also trying to think of ways in which the model could become more replicable, which is how I got to the work-study part of the answer. Please. Yeah.
Is it safe to say that, because I don't know as well as I should, that at Amherst in that 19th century model, the vast majority of your students are what we call traditional college-age students?
Yes.
Because one thought is, I mean, since I've been teaching here, I've had students from age 16 to 87. Those are my two records. I'm working on trying hard to get another one on either end. And pretty much everything in between. And it strikes me that when we think in terms of access, that's
right.
An area that all our traditional private liberal arts colleges really need to open their eyes and think outside the box. Because I'm delighted that you're working with Jack Penn Cook, because among other things, some of those scholarships are probably going to be going to some people of non-traditional college age. But one of our missions at the community college is to welcome lifelong learners, and specifically those who may be a victim of a school system, as you said. In your example about South Africa, people who can move ahead in spite of what has happened before them. And they don't always do it on schedule, you know?
Right.
And so if you're looking for ways to increase access specifically at Amherst or colleges like Amherst, my questions would be, what kind of aid is available, perhaps like the Smith and Mount Holyoke models of the Francis Perkins and Peter Comstock scholarships?
Right.
And also, what is life like on your campus for a woman my age coming back to college for the first time, having raised my kids, for example? This would
right.
be an excellent area that I think it would really behoove the private colleges to look at.
Well, I agree with you, and we have looked at it, but I will confess we have not pursued it. So let me just describe to you the reasoning that went behind that decision. First thing you just need to understand is, I mean, one of the reasons why we are the most selective and the most diverse liberal arts college is we're also teeny, right? I mean, that makes it so much easier. No, I'm serious. It's not the only reason, but just think about the math involved, right? So very few spaces, very precious spaces, right? Kids crazily fighting for those spaces, right? So we worry about spreading our net even further, including intergenerationally. We don't worry about spreading our net within that age cohort, right? We're committed to having as broad a base, you know, considering us as we can possibly encourage. Not because we need more numbers of applicants, but because we believe that's fundamental to the education we provide and the values that we want to model for our students and for ourselves. If you spread it beyond that intergenerationally, then I guarantee you I'm going to start hearing from various constituent groups within the single age cohort that we've just lost precious spaces, right? So it's not a fully fixed game, fixed in the sense of the total number. In fact, the college is growing at the moment a bit, precisely because of this question, because of this pressure, and saying maybe we can maintain our quality and do a little bit more given the resources that we have. But there's still that sense of zero sum, and it gets into some divisive politics sometimes that are not so helpful.
That Williams has followed you, so if Amherst were to lead, perhaps
right.
The Middlebury's in the
right.
Fall along.
So the college, I'm just going to be honest about this. The college did do more of this a generation ago, the last time we went into such a partnership. And accurate or not, there are a set of apocryphal, perhaps, stories on campus about students for whom we sort of stretched, including in age, in ways that were felt didn't work out. And that became the excuse for why we shouldn't partner with the community colleges. So part of the way we got into this partnership again was to say, well, let's try this again, but not push on the intergenerational question. Now, maybe that will prove to be transitional, or maybe it'll just be the way we can do it, right? I'm just being honest with you about how we got there. Please.
I'm thinking a lot about your experience in South Africa, too, and thinking about the mission of community colleges and how we're very much paralleling what you talked about in 1 or 2 years, and sometimes much longer, preparing students from this economic apartheid to compete with on a much broader scale. And I wonder about, in addition to sending students out into the world to be civically minded through work study fellowships and those kinds of opportunities, I wonder about the faculty at an institution like Amherst College reaching out and spreading their possible benefit to society. We have fantastic faculty on our campus who devote their lives to helping these students. And we're also at a huge deficit of faculty, full-time faculty, because of budget, you know, and to think of the possibilities that could be given to our students by having an Amherst College professor come and teach a political science class, or the opportunity of one of our faculty to come and teach to an Amherst College group of students. I think that would be another tremendous way to create that civic engagement and exchange.
I will think about that one too, and I will talk to my colleagues about it. I think it is an interesting question. I will confess to you, I know my faculty at Amherst or my colleagues, you know, better than I know all of you all, and I know some who are doing things like that and involved in the community colleges and both as teachers. I know some who are serving as trustees and, you know, advisors in various ways. And you know, as part of the same issue of sort of expanding this cooperation, I've obviously, you know, sort of I've raised that flag, so I guess I have to salute it. I think we should explore those possibilities further, and I'll, you know, certainly we can continue that conversation. You know, I really do believe what I said, that we will all do better if we can find ways to cooperate in substantive ways. There will be resistances to that. There are cultural resistances, there are economic resistances, historical resistances, you know, all sorts, right? And that will mean we may take some, you know, careful steps to build confidence before we can take the next steps. I will tell you that there are people who probably think I've already taken too many steps. I don't pay too much attention to that, so I am interested in continuing the conversation there. The simple fact is the future of the country will rest, in my view, or I wouldn't do what I do for a living, on getting these issues solved in the higher education system. It's not the only problem we have, obviously, but I do think it's a crucial one. And I am mindful, and I think the institution that I head must be mindful, of the fact that others watch what we do, and that therefore we need to do the right thing all the more, because whether we like it or not, we're leaders in this. And that means when we have rhetoric about finding ways to cooperate more, we best live up to it, both for the substantive effects and again, because we're trying to inculcate, to teach the notion of acting on your beliefs, even when it's hard. So that's a somewhat vague commitment to pursue this further. Thank you all for coming.